Of all things that move and move not, none is to equal those whose minds are set on the transcendent with determination and a high horse silver away.
And you will find that you've arrived in Frightenstein. Perhaps the Count will find a way to make his monster work today. For if he solves this monster mania, he can return to Transylvania. So welcome where the sun won't shine, to the castle of Count Frightenstein.
You little devils. A tool by any other name still smells awful. I give up on you guys. You're late again, Igor. And what was that sound I heard outside?
I was outside, Master, playing tennis.
It's a lousy racket. You laugh when the Count makes a joke. Stop laughing. For now is the time that we raise the flag and sing our national anthem. I'll count you in. One, two, three, in.
Gory, gory, Transylvania. The werewolves and bats will always maim ya. The Mackie Moore will likely claim ya as we go stumbling through.
You wouldn't know ukulele lady, would you? I pledge by the sign of the three-toed sloth to do my best to do my duty, to always obey the laws of the werewolf pack, and to never rest until Brucey lives once more and takes his rightful place in the annals of distinguished monsters. And I can once again return to that most glorious of homeland, Transylvania.
As we go stumbling-ing.
Stumbling-ing?
Stumbling-ing.
You have heard a master, a count, a wondrous human being.
Shalyapin couldn't do it better.
All right, explain yourself. Now, what were you doing?
I was outside, master, playing tennis.
But what would take you so long to play tennis?
Well, master, I was playing by myself, and it takes twice as long.
You're out of sight.
Can't be. Water in his traveling was one time almost drowned when while at sea he heard the cry, "Watch out, we're going down." Bwana knew that he must jump although he could not swim, and jumping very nearly proved to be the end of him, for Bwana in his panic did not know that he had been sailing across the ocean on an atomic submarine.
Chinese airtime!
Thank you. And how are you? Very nice for you to drop in and see me. This is Moana Clyde Batty at your service here at Zany Zoo. Very strange indeed. What's Robin Hood doing in these forests? It isn't Sherwood, you know. They're getting very restless, I might say. All right, now. As I was saying, I'm Bawana Clyde Batty, and I have some lovely film for you to see of all our gorgeous creatures, and I'm sure you're going to love them. So why don't we get ourselves over to the projector and see what we shall see. All right, now away we go. Come on, folks, here we go. Going to the projector, reels in place, right. Okay, focus in, switch on, and what do we see? Hello, 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 and what have we got here? Do you know what that is? That is a Gila monster. Oh, look at that, would you? Now, they're very, very interesting, they are. Now, also in this same area, there's the Mexican beaded lizard. Now, these are the only two poisonous lizards of this region. Isn't that interesting, eh? Very nice, eh? Now, the Gila monster grows up to 23 inches in length and weighs up to 3.25 pounds. Now, it's mainly pink with yellow and black shading. Oh, look at that. Hello there. Hello. Taking a little look-see, are you? Now, the Gila monster has 4 to 5 dot bands on its tail. Oh, and look at the length of that tongue, would you? Oh, Gila monster speak with forked tongue. Oh, my goodness. Wouldn't want to meet him on a dark night, eh? No, sir. That's right. Look at that. My goodness. Oh, yes. Look at that. It's like Indian handiwork, isn't it? Look at all the beads around him there. Well, that must be what the beaded lizard is then, eh? That's right. Hello, hello. Yes, you're very pretty. We know that, sir. Very nice, too. Now, the Mexican beaded lizard grows up to 32 inches long, and it's mainly black with pink and yellow patches, as you can see. All right, mate. Yeah. Give us a kiss, eh? Would you give us a kiss? For Bawana Clyde Batty. That's right.
Loved it, loved it. Did you like that film? I thought it was just great, didn't you? Thank you for giving me credit for my efforts. And as we always have to say when we end the day here at Zany Zoo, ooga booga, which in this case means the ghost of an image reflects nothing except pomposity and the absurd negligence-wise. Right, all right. It looks like my launch has just arrived, so I'll be taking a trip upriver to see the Count and all his friends. All right, bye-bye now. Ta-ra, mates, and have a good time.
I enjoy seeing animals. I like them, eh?
Stop. Please stop. It's enough.
5, 4, 3, 2, Ooga Booga. We'll be back.
If yesterday was Monday, and today is Sunday, this must be Frankenstein.
The Oracle was gazing into his crystal ball and saw a crazy sight that did not make much sense at all. It was a polar bear in flames who did a hula wiggle, and 20 mice dressed up as clowns who clapped their hands and giggled. The Oracle was baffled, and this sight filled him with dread. So he got up from the crystal ball, and this is what he said. This vision is quite silly and crazy as can be. Something round here's cracked all right, that crystal ball or me.
Welcome. I am the mighty and magnificent oracle, clairvoyant divine, palm reader superb, philanthropist, extraordinary. And I'm afraid, in general, a butterfingers. And now for a sign for today. All swirling mist from the gods have kissed. Which sign, whose life, will fortune twist? And the sign today is Libra. Oh, gentle Libra. Now, that is all the kids who are born between September 23rd and October 22nd. Now, the sign for Libra is the scales, the symbol of justice. Yes, yes, that is a very good thing to have, justice. And now we... I think I've done it again. And now, oh, magic crystal, crystal ball, tell me now. Tell me all. Yes. All right, Libra. Beware of a 250-pound Sagittarius who likes to tickle people. Now is a good time for all the kids and Libras to look back and see what you have accomplished. This review will be invaluable in deciding where you are going from now on, you see. And that is a very important thing. You must review what you have done and in your schoolwork. If it is not up to par, you must work harder and bring it up to par. And now I must answer your lovely letters that you send me. I hope I know the answer to this one. Dear Oracle, can you recognize what a person's sign is when you first meet them? That is a very good question. Well, as you study astrology deeper and deeper, you'll find that each sign has its own distinctive personality and makeup. Now, Geminis are talkative and friendly, inquisitive. Pisces are moody, whereas Leos, well, there's something else. After studying all the signs, you get to sense exactly what sign people are born under. Try studying all your relatives and friends. That should take some time. You'll discover they all fall into recognized patterns of their signs. It really shouldn't work, but it does. Don't you think so, Buddha? I mean, after all, you have been with me on all of these occasions. Oh! Wish somebody would stop the gong, man. Please, look to the stars.
Grunk!
Hello, Grunk. How are you today?
Just grunk.
Grunk, eh?
Grunk.
I've been reading some very interesting things in this book here.
Sure.
You know, things weren't always so modern and convenient as they are today.
Really?
You know, in the old days, you couldn't always take a steamship to Europe?
Of course not. Sometimes you take a steamship to China. I'd love to take you in a steamship to China.
No, that's very cute, but that's not what I mean. Now, in the old days, there weren't even such things as steamships. You had to travel in a sailing ship.
And what were they like?
Well, if we don't understand something, what do we do?
We'll look it up.
That's right. Sure. And I have a book here that tells us everything we ever wanted to know about traveling in a sailing ship.
Really? What's it called?
It's called Everything We've Ever Wanted to Know About Traveling in a Sailing Ship.
Gronk.
All right, I caught you again. Well, it says that in the early days, the cargo was considered to be more important than the passengers.
No kidding.
Yes, to cross the Atlantic, it took, well over...
$2.
$2.
Sure.
No, that's not right.
It's not?
It's not, no. Of course it was over $2.
Of course it was over.
That's not the kind of thing we say here. I'm trying to read it as it's written.
Oh, back to the book.
All right. What I'm saying is sometimes it took well over 3 weeks. That's more like it.
Of
3 weeks.
3 weeks.
To cross the Atlantic. And the early sailing ships provided very few comforts.
No floor, no roof, no food. Sure.
No floor.
Bad scene, you know?
No floor.
No floor.
Of course there was no floor. What are you talking about? There had to be a floor.
Okay.
My.
There was a floor.
Strike, no floor. A very strange, enchanted floor. One day we walked it. No, never mind. All right.
Moving right along.
Yes. What they didn't have was movies or restaurants or the things you find in our big ocean liners.
Like grumpy waiters.
Like grumpy waiters.
Sure. They didn't have that.
Give me the strength to hang on for just a little while. That's all I ask.
Back to the book.
Back to the book.
Sure.
If you'll allow me.
Okay, here we go.
All right. The people on ocean liners are very nice, you see.
Sure. Now
you must understand. When there were storms, the people had to stay in their cabins for days at a time.
Really?
This way, your ancestors probably came to North America.
Like that?
Like that.
How about that?
That's right.
Jeez.
So you see what I mean? Travel in those days was no picnic.
No picnic.
Just be glad you weren't traveling on a sailing ship in, say, 1772, eh?
You're darn right I'm glad.
Right.
See, if I was on a sailing ship in 1772, I'd be only 200 years old today, a mere child. Mere child. Wrong.
From the source of the highest, to be known paths of purification, and the multitudinous sons of all things that return to nature. What does it all mean?
Griselda thought that she would make a pan of chocolate fudge, but what she ended up with was a pan of chocolate sludge. She got her squares of chocolates and placed them in the tray, then put them on the stove to melt, then left and went away. Her bowl was made of plastic, so that when our cook returned, she found a melted lump in flames and half the kitchen burned. But Griselda didn't mind at all. She said it didn't matter, and scraped the gloop from off the stove and threw it in the batter.
What kind of ghoul am I? What do I do in life? It seems whenever I prepare my food, I cut my thumb with a knife. Oh, come on into Happiness Street. It's really fun in here. And we have a recipe for you today that you're just going to love. It's a little simple dish called Rico's Specialty, Ping Pong Pizza. Here we go. Now, for the first ingredient of the ping pong pizza. Oh, my goodness, the old ping pong. Well, in she goes. Where she lands, nobody knows. Why would you put that down in there? Here we go. Now, we get the old ball bouncing. Oh, that should put a lot of bounce into it. Now, what are we going to have? Of course, we're going to have the old favorite. Oh, watch the wax. Love the eggs. Oh, the old ping pong ball. My goodness. Yes, lovely. Now, oh, we haven't had some pickle plasma for some time. So let's just try the old pickle plasma, looking good. Woo! Now, mix thoroughly. Just lovely, shaping up. Love it, love it, love it.
Rita Hayward, eat your heart out.
Oh, and here we are. Oh, you have a clothes peg, which is usually on a clothesline. Hey. Have you got a hotline up to the old man upstairs, eh? Is he still looking at the pictures?
Well, as you well know, when mixing things in Griselda's kitchen, it becomes quite an involved affair. Therefore, I've had the specialty of this particular cabinet built just for my needs. And guess what we're going to use today? Yes, you guessed it. Something so intricate and hard to get that you wouldn't believe it. A tomato. Come with me. We're just having fun and we're going over here. That's where we're going. And here we are with the tomato. All right? Now, into the old car. Oh, that was a large tomato, wasn't it? That being done, we're now back at the old mixing bowl. Now we're going to the cauldron to mix it all up. How wonderful. Here we are. Oh. Now, here we are in the cauldron, and in go the goodies. Cauldron, 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 bubble. Cauldron boiling, cauldron bubble. Okay, taster's time. That is the worst! I've had some bad stuff, but
We ever do this thing again? Well,
don't be cruel to toads.
Brucey isn't gonna work in a million years.
All right, come over there.
Who sent for you?
Never mind that.
Hammer, Bammer, Hammer, Igor now.
Of course not. Say, I hope you're well today, Igor.
I hope you're not well today, Igor.
You see, you
All right, Igor, word reaches me that you don't know much about the English language.
Who, me?
I was right. Now, I distinctly heard you say, and let's have an instant replay on this, please. Brucey isn't gonna work in a million years.
Wrong.
Why is that wrong?
Because he isn't gonna work in a trillion or even a zillion years.
No, that's wrong, Igor.
Yeah, well.
Grammar, slammer, hammer, Igor.
Never mind.
No, not yet. Igor, instead of saying Brucey isn't gonna work in a million years, what should you have said?
Brucey never washes the dishes.
No,
Hammer, Igor, now!
No, we'll give him one more chance.
Give us a couple of chances. I'm not sure about this.
Now, Igor, it isn't Brucey isn't gonna work in a million years. It's Brucey isn't.
Brucey isn't, isn't,
Come on, Brucey, isn't.
Slowly now, just. Patience is a virtue, you know that.
Hammer now!
Not yet. Brucey isn't going to work.
That's right.
Let's
have the corrected version, please. Brucey isn't going to work. Very good, Igor.
Mr. Slammer
Bammer. Hammer Igor tomorrow?
No.
Hey, wait a minute. That might be a good idea.
Why doesn't Vincent Price ever introduce me? I'm a count.
The librarian will often read some short detective tales that tell of murder in the streets and how it ends in jails. I went once for a visit and I found him reading late. He told me he'd not finished yet, so would I kindly wait? The book that he was reading was one that he'd read before. I told him this, but all he did was bellow out a roar. Reading books is not so bad, it's all on how you view it. And this time as I read, I find the butler didn't do it.
Along came a beggar boy and put me in his bag. He took me up to London. A lady did me by, put me in a silver cage, and hung me up on high. It's getting me. With apples by the fire and nuts for to crack, and besides a little feather bed to rest my little back. Terrified? You must be. All right, I'll get you with this one. Pop goes the weasel.
Yes.
Up and down the Ditty Road, in and out of the Eagle. That's the way the money goes. Pop goes the weasel.
Huh? Yes, it's getting on.
Half a pound of tuppenny rice, half a pound of treacle. Mix it up and make it nice. Pop goes the weasel. Pop goes the weasel. No? Right. Every night when I go out, the monkey's on the table. Take a stick and knock it off. Pop goes the weasel. More. Sally go round the sun. Sally go round the moon. Sally go round the chimney pots on a Saturday afternoon. That must have gotten you. That's horrible, terrifying. No. I'll try again. What's the news? What's the news of the day? Good neighbor, I pray. They say the balloon is gone up to the moon. Oh, fear. I know fear now, don't you? The last one. Yeah, I'll get you with this. The sky. Red sky at night. Shepherd's delight. Red sky in the morning. Shepherds, take warning. Yes, terrifying, isn't it? What's the use? I try and try. But I will. I'll get you. The next time we meet, I'll get you as sure as I am the librarian, and this is Polly. But until that time, I grow weary now. And so I say goodbye.
Meanwhile, back at my crystal ball.
I like pet bet. Quite nice. Quite nice.
One of Pet Vet's animals was an old alley cat. He lived inside a garbage can and was extremely fat. It seemed to be a lazy sort, quite useless as a ratter. But Pet Vet told me that he thought it really didn't matter. He said he made some use of it each night when gone to bed, for it became a pillow when it slept beneath his head.
Yes, Dr. Petvet, a mummy and a baby. I've got them right here by me. What a lovely pair of dogs. Very, I never heard of it. A saluki, you say? Yes. Well, I'm just going to read about it now. Okay, I'll call you later. Goodbye. Thank you. I'm going to read Dr. Petvet's letter now. Dear Igor, I am sending you two dogs today of the saluki. One is a mummy and the other is a baby. That's a dog and a puppy, like. These dogs come from Arabia where they hunted gazelle on the deserts. They are therefore known as gazelle hounds in Arabia. That makes sense. They become popular in England in 1935 and in North America in 1950. They were considered holy dogs in Arabia, like the holy cows in India. They come in different colors, fawn, red and black and tan, and grizzle, which is a color that's all mixture. Very good with children and very intelligent sight hounds. That means they see and not smell when they hunt. Ah, yes, sight instead of, makes sense. Anyhow, this one is 5 weeks old. Oh, such a baby dog. And will grow up to 25 to 28 inches and will be 60, 70 pounds. My, you're going to be big one day. I wish I could keep you and feed you and look after you. Yes. Oh, hang on, hang on. Hello? Yes, doctor, I just finished the letter. Yeah, fantastic dogs run up to 45 miles per hour. Shee, that's faster than a horse. I wish I could, I can keep them? Dr. Petvet, I'll just put you on hold. Hang on a second, I want to check with the slot. Good. Hello, Mr. Slot? Yes, Igor. I just want to keep the pets a couple of days. Never mind. Hello, Dr. Petvet? Yes. No, it didn't let me keep it.
And this puppy is so beautiful. The mummy is also nice. The guy just sits so calm.
Dr. Petvet looks like a chipmunk.
Malt Company,
8 goulars.
Malt Company, please, Igor. I'm trying to add up my goulars here. The bills I owe.
Can I help you, mister?
Well, maybe you can. I'm going to test you on something. How much is 12 goulars, 8 goulars, and 5 goulars?
25 goulars, mister.
That's very fast. I'll try another one on you. All right, how much is 19 goulars, 18 goulars, 17 goulars, and 12 goulars?
I don't know, master.
That's what I mean, don't you see? We waste our time so much trying to add up goulars all the time.
Right, master.
There's got to be an answer somewhere.
I have an idea, master.
What is that?
Perhaps with your great, prolific brain, that fantastic insight into eye probing science, you could invent something to count goulars.
I don't think so, Igor. But what I really should do, I feel, is to invent something that can count goulars. Yes, the thought just hit me.
Yes, master.
Why not? Of course, I can do it. It's planning in my head right now. All right, hand me my toolbox.
Your toolbox?
All right. Why not, big fellow? I'm going to the workshop to do it now. Ha-ha! I'm coming with you. Lost some of my tools, but it's all right. I am finished already.
That was a quick job, master.
All right, now I am going to test my voice-activated goulard adder.
Wow!
Okay, here we go.
I'll be a witness.
All right, voice-activated goulard counter. How much is 19 goulards, 18 goulards, 17 goulards, and 12 goulards?
Could you repeat the question?
Of course, of course. It's working, it's working. How much is 19 goulars, 18 goulars, 17 goulars, and 12 goulars?
Boy, that's a toughie. Could you ask me an easier one?
All right, how much is 2 goulars and 2 goulars?
4 goulars. 4 goulars.
4 goulars, goulars.
I've seen bad, but do you believe?
If you're lucky, I'll be back.
You know, I know a little mosquito who left home because he found his parents repellent. You get it? Play on. Well, that's funny. No? Well, I think so. Anyway, it's lunchtime.
Oh, the professor got some chemicals, a bowl and electric mixer, announcing that he would invent a tasty new elixir. This brew, he said, will bring you health and cure all earthly ills and be a lot more pleasant than a lot of nasty pills. He made mistakes, 'cause brewing something he'd not done before. And what he thought was H2O was H2SO4. That is sulfuric acid, which he should have thrown away. Still, he sold that cure-all potion to a firm that makes fly spray.
How do you do, ladies and gentlemen, and men and women, and people and others? I am Julius Sumner Miller, Professor Julius Sumner Miller. And professor of what? Our business is physics. And physics is what? Physics, I suppose I would say, is what physicists do. And somebody says, now, professor, that is circular thinking. Physics is what physicists do. Sure, what does a carpenter do? He does carpentering. And what do physicists do? They explore how nature behaves. So I left you last time with an inquiry of a common sort, but one which many, many, many get wrong. We are to imagine that I have two identical vessels, one filled with milk and one with cream. They are now, you see, empty vessels. How many see that? Oh, those of you who said they are empty. No, that is not right. They have air in them. They are not empty. I will show you later that I can't have an empty vessel. Never have an empty vessel. Not on the Earth, maybe on the Moon. You follow me, all right. So the question is, one filled with milk and one with cream, and which is the heavier? How many agree that the cream is the heavier? How many agree that the milk is the heavier? Those of you who said that the cream is heavier will have to be sent to the seventh layer of some place named by Dante. Because the cream is not heavier. The milk is the heavier. Cream is oil, and oil is lighter than water. And I know why you said the cream is heavier. Because it is thick and viscous and sluggish. And furthermore, those of you who are too young have lived only in the age of homogenization, and you have never seen an old-fashioned quart of milk with the cream on top.
The professor is certainly clever, but me, hey.
So those of you who said the cream is heavier, down, I say. The milk is heavier. I think that's wonderful. More now on Mr. Newton and the first law. A body at rest wishes to remain at rest, or if moving uniformly in a straight line, that's what it wants to do. And look how wonderfully simply I can demonstrate that. We will imagine that this is a heavy hammerhead, heavy, like a sledgehammer. And here is the handle which I lodge in it, and it's held by friction. Now, how can I put that handle into that head further? Just like this. Hold it so. The head has large inertia. I hit so, and the head has the handle driven into it. Case one. Case two. Let me start all over. I lodge the head on the handle ever so, and now I do as follows. Bang. What happens now? The motion of the handle is brought to rest by engaging the table. The head was also moving, but when the handle stopped, what did the head do? It kept moving. And so this is a wonderful demonstration of Newton's first law, which I say has two parts not usually delineated. A body at rest wishes to remain at rest, or if moving uniformly in a straight line, wants to do that.
Out of sight!
Master.
What, Igor?
I've been thinking.
That would be a change.
Thank you very much, Master.
You're welcome.
Well, what I was thinking about, not really thinking, wondering, why we can't make Brucey work? I want to go back to Transylvania.
Well, don't you think I want to go back, too? Yes, what we had... Wait a minute, why not?
Why not?
Now I see it as clear as night. Listen, you know why Brucey won't work? He has no discipline.
Discipline?
What we need around this castle is some good old-fashioned military discipline.
Run a tight ship.
That's the idea, Igor.
Yes.
All right, I want you to go and get our uniforms and our bubble guns.
Bubble guns?
Of course. You know I don't believe in violence.
Oh, you don't like violence. You like trombones. I'll get
them. Talk it smart, Igor. No, the only kind of war to have is a jelly bean war. You can eat all the ammunition. Hurry up, Igor. I'm going to take command of the ship. Well done, Igor. Yes, the bubble gun. Let's go. All right, now.
This one is a private.
That's right.
There's another private.
All right, we'll put this on Brucey.
And this one is for the general. Who's the general?
Who else would be the general?
Not yet. Oh, you're the general.
Of course I'm the general. Look at this, Igor.
Oh, that's pretty good, Master.
All right, now, let's do some close-order drilling. Here, take his bubble gun, and I'll take my bubble gun. Brucey, well, just pretend for now. Just pretending he's got a gun. Just pretending that. All right, Igor, now some close-order drills. Are you ready? All right, shoulder arms. Never mind, you already got it up there. Present arms. Right, no, Igor. When you present arms, you pull them up like this and smash your helmet. Present arms. Not that hard, Igor. All right, right face. About face. Left turn. Mark. Mark. Ten. Two. Hey.
Curtain sound. You're in the army, Mr. Jones.
You're in the army, Mr. Jones.
No private rooms or telephones. You had your breakfast in bed before, but you won't have it there anymore. What are we doing? Brucey, during this whole thing, you haven't done a thing.
Master, he hasn't done nothing since he's been in the army. Absolutely nothing. I mean, what are you going to do? He hasn't done one single thing. I've been doing exercises and everything.
Igor, now it becomes very plain to me. When a person is in the army as long as he's been in the army and does absolutely nothing, there is only one thing left for him to be.
Well, Master, when a person is in the army for as long as he's been in the army, what do you see he deserve? What are you going to do to him?
Igor, when someone's been in the army as long as he's been in the army, there's only one thing to do with him, Igor, and that is... make him a general!
It isn't fair!
The Count and Igor, Gronk.
I am the Wolfman. How do you do and how are you? I am the Wolfman coming to you from radio station EECH, brought to you by Dracola, the Dracola company of the world. Ah, yes, Count. Okay. Glad you liked it. Good. Well, that's groovy. He said I finally got the thing right. Haha. And remember, gang, we believe in the wolf. Now it's chime time. And the time is... missed completely. All right. According to the old dart in the wall, it's time to TCB. Busy. TCB, take care of business. And we got a beauty here called PlayGirl. It was done way back in 1968 by the three prophets. So why don't we take it?
Drink the undrinkable.
Today, Harvey Sunclanger.
No, it's not. I'm fine, and it's wall-banger.
I know what it was. I knew it all the time.
You just wanted to hear me sing it.
Yes, because you are in very good voice today. Wallabanger. Very good, Harvey. Is there any mail?
Yes, there is. Today, two or three letters came in, and you can read one of them right now.
Well, I hope it's to me. I wouldn't want to read anybody else's mail.
Oh, no, it's for you.
All right.
It's the one marked number one. That one.
Oh!
And not that one and that one.
That's the one, all right.
That's it.
That's really hard.
Is that typo?
All right. O positive.
Ha, 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 ha.
Or what have you?
Accentuate the positive.
Never mind that. We must get down to business here. Dear Count, and there it is again, those wonderful words. Is it true that Bologna Clyde Batty waxes his mustache? Well, that is a vicious rumor. Very, very bad. No, he does not wax his whiskers at all. No, no. He's a clean-cut boy.
Oh.
And you remember that, Franklin, eh? And we'll send you a picture, of course.
That was a good joke.
Well, I think so. I think I'm going to have to go now. Very sorry about that, Harvey. Marty Banger?
Oh, come on now. It's Harvey Wallbanger.
Wrong.
The castle lights are growing dim. There's no one left but me and him. When next we meet in Frankenstone, don't come alone.
This show is definitely over.